Welcome to FASA Con and welcome to my presentation, given the overly verbose title, Magical Discussion about the Enchanting Topic of Sorcery Designs and Witchy Spells, Divination of What's Behind the Veil. In reality, we're going to be talking about the tentatively titled forthcoming book I've been working on, Magic Deeper Secrets. Before I get too much into this, I want to spend a moment to give special thanks to Brett Bone and David Marshall. David's been on my design team from the very beginning with the 4th edition Player's Guide, and Brett came into the fold after that, primarily helping with Mystic Paths, and 4th edition really would not be as good without their help. They check over my work, see my blind spots, edit for clarity for other human beings. Thanks, guys. All your work means a great deal to me and everyone else. So here's the proposed outline that I have for Magic Deeper Secrets and the topics we're going to be covering today. The biggest focus on the spells, particularly high circle spells that I know everyone wants. There's going to be new knacks, additional improved spell knacks, and binding secrets, both of which were first introduced in the Adept's Journey, Mystic Paths, new types of enchanting, and then hopefully there'll be a section on familiars and perhaps some bonus material if there is time and space. The proposed structure for Magic Deeper Secrets that I'd really like to have is for each chapter to address one of those topics and be prefaced with in-setting discussion that gives structure to the book as a whole and make it exist within the setting. And of course, there'll be the sidebars and commentary on that discussion to give depth and cast some doubt onto the veracity of everything that's being claimed in there, because unreliable narrator is a key part of how the setting is portrayed. But following that, there's going to be the actual mechanics, and I'd like to have a layout difference between them to have the mechanics be clean and not really distract from being able to look up material, and so that if you're looking at the side of the book, hopefully there will be some distinction on the color of the section so you can more easily flip to the area you'd like to go to. Now, for spells, which is really a bulk of the work that's been going on, there are new and updated spells for all 5 of the spellcasting disciplines from circles 1 through 15. There's a lot of the old spells will be returning. There's also new spells, and some of the old spells from previous editions will actually be coming back as improved spell knacks, as they don't stand on their own very well as a distinct spell, but instead augment something existing from an earlier circle and make more sense using that structure, which is why many of them were cut previously, as the player's guide wasn't a good place to introduce that mechanic, and the companion, which would have been a good place, simply didn't have any spells in it due to space and time limitations. And of course, in ensuring that spellcaster themes are maintained, there are some spells that have been having their circles altered and moved between the disciplines, as we really tighten down on how those themes in each discipline were explored to try and make each more distinctive, rather than having a more cafeteria style where there's certain things that everyone could do. While in particular, good examples, healing. Whereas in previous editions, every discipline had access to a healing spell, where this is now more limited to 3 disciplines. So among those goals, there's at least 5 spells from circles 1 through 8, and in circles 9 through 15, a lot of those spells are getting expanded and revised. We're trying to keep the power level in line with the trajectory of all the disciplines, so high circle magicians don't overpower and outshine everyone else in the group, as was really problematic in the case, but at the same time, those spells feel big and important. So that's a pretty fine line to tread, and is taking time to get just right in terms of accessibility, use, and to not break the setting by their very existence. So here's a preview of one of those spells. It's Liquid Arrow. It's a second circle spell from the Elementalist discipline, and it's a pretty basic damaging spell. The updates to it in the previous editions was a 4 circle spell that did significantly more damage, but it was altered because that really wasn't important. It does will plus 2 now instead of will plus 7. I've got an overview of the changes. The circle is reduced, the number of threads were reduced, the effect step was reduced, and the range was increased. What that gives is a low circle damage spell that is something Elementalist didn't really have previously at 0 threads, is long range. The damage increases with successes, and it fills a niche they didn't have, which is useful. But it wasn't a good fit at higher circles because you have spells like Fire Spear, and most higher circle spells have interesting writers on them, whereas not having a writer is more appropriate for lower circle spells. Here's a new spell for Elementalist. It's 5th circle, and it's called Air Sentry, and most disciplines get some some kind of alarm in Deeper Secrets, and this is the Elementalist alarm. These spells are meant to show off how the disciplines can approach a similar problem in different ways, and that is being notified of intruders. And since Elementalists have a connection with spirits, there's a value in having your detection system be invisible. This is where this comes in. They also didn't have a lot of air spells at the time, so trying to fill in those blanks and give more even access to all different elements was important in ensuring we cover all the bases there. So another returning favorite spell, well, maybe not favorite for everyone, but we have Fatal Food, which is a Nethermancer spell, and it remains at fourth circle. Some of the changes to that one, most notably, is it doesn't explode anymore, at least in this version of it. We decided to move to poisoning the food instead, as that's a more classic way to handle Fatal Food, and seems appropriate and subtle for Nethermancers, as making someone detonate was a little more obvious than most players were likely to want when using this kind of a spell. However, this is a good example of where we introduced improved spell knacks to cover some of these spaces where the improved spell knacks give a lot of different options on how you implement your Fatal Food, to introducing different kinds of poisons, debilitating poison, paralytic poison, the exploding food that perhaps you really want to come back, and improved versions of the poisons so that you can get exactly the kind of Fatal Food you need at the time. Another new spell, this is wholly new, is Netherwave. It is a sixth circle Nethermancer spell. It should be pretty obvious. This one has the benefit of a low thread for the circle, area of effect spell that does mystic damage, and also reduces the initiative of everyone around the Nethermancer. Since Nethermancers aren't necessarily as friendly as Elementalists, that means they don't get to remove allies from the area, but at the same time, that is a nice way for a Nethermancer to deal with it if they're getting overwhelmed by enemies. So this is a different kind of tool in their toolkit to have, and they didn't really have anything quite like this previously. So moving on to the knacks section of the book, there's a lot of knacks. There truly are so many knacks. It is hard to describe it, honestly. I want to say my knacks development page is probably 134 pages in the draft formatting I use. I don't know exactly how many of them will make it, and the odds are more knacks will be developed from there. One of the big goals for knacks was especially to pay attention to non-spellcasters. There are knacks in there for spellcasters, as you'll see shortly, but as much of the book is focused on spellcasters themselves, I wanted to be careful to pay special attention to non-spellcasters and make sure there's a lot in here for them as well, that they don't get left out. Their concerns and what they want are addressed, because as we all know, if there's more material focused on one group over another, that means they tend to creep forward in the general scope of power simply by the more options available, and design teams staying cognizant of that fact, and also really working hard to limit power creep in general. It's not going to be entirely possible simply because more options means more ways to do things, and that means there is going to be some level of power creep by releasing new material. No matter what, we are paying attention to it and not trying to go through the process of using power creep to sell new books, because that just makes the setting and game worse as a whole. One of the big things for this is new knacks at rank 9 plus talents, and for the warden tier and above talents. And none of those were actually, well, there was a couple, but they were more continuations of previous knacks, such as the ally augment, a series of animal companion knacks, and the strength of metal knacks that allow you to wear heavier armor with reduced initial penalties. But these are ones that are truly high rank knacks. Some have shown up in stick paths, but this addresses the non-path specific knacks. There was a number written for mystic paths that worked better as generic knacks, even if they were appropriate for a mystic path. They weren't necessarily more appropriate for the path than everyone else, so they were pulled from there, and they'll be part of this book. So there's a variety of access points for knacks there, but all of the higher circle knacks are present. And here's a preview of one of them. This is the Armor Cutter special maneuver. It gives some emphasis to using a two-handed weapon, and you've seen this special maneuver on creatures almost certainly, and it allows you to reduce their physical armor instead of improving your damage. And we have Firefly Lure, which is an act that I've wanted to have for a very long time because of the visual associated with it. This is an act that will likely appeal to supporting close combatants who want to be stickier to their opposition than Distract normally allows. Distract has some emphasis naturally on keeping focused on the combatant, though most players will combine that with increases to their physical defense, which doesn't necessarily make them any more appealing of a target other than the enabling of blindside to their allies with surprise strike, and people using surprise strike tend to be squishier. These are all tactical considerations. This one kind of does the reverse of that, where as long as they're attacking the distracting character, they aren't blindsided, but as soon as they don't include the distracting character, they are blindsided, so that makes them considerably stickier than distract does. And then we have Incite Monologue, which is an enhancement to engaging banter, one that I quite like, for engaging banter can honestly be a fairly limited talent, and this expands what it can do and allows you to keep someone occupied with their pontificating as you make good on an escape, which entertains me a little bit and can be fairly useful, particularly in how you can use engaging banter with your group. Then we have Lancer, which is a cavalryman knack, specifically designed to give them more options on how to use their abilities when they're not mounted. It also emphasizes lances, so this should give a little more power to cavalrymen who aren't mounted and are using a lance. Then we have Signature Spell, and as you'll note, that's Signature Spell 1. This is a pattern craft knack, which gives a small boost to spellcasters and a particular spell, kind of helping them keep up a little bit with damage. Since the number of knacks you can have is limited, this makes them start focusing more on their favorite spells. While they can still have the portfolio of spells at their disposal, some will just be a little bit better, hence it being their signature spell. This brings us to Improved Spell Knacks, as I talked about before. And if you're familiar with the Depth Journey Mixes Paths, it introduces them, and that's where you first see a lot of them. However, Deeper Secrets expands that considerably, given that it's focusing on all spells and not just spells particularly appropriate to a path. One of the big things for a improved spell knack is it gives spellcasters a lot more versatility on how they can use their spells and more options while still being limited to the number of matrices they can use. The cost of this, of course, is strain. Spellcasters don't have a lot of strain to spend to begin with, given their very low durability. And just in case you were ever jealous that your warrior allies seem to be dying more by their hand than their enemies, you can take part in that fun too. So here's a preview of one of them. There's actually a chain of these for Earth Darts, given that it's starter spell for elementalists for combat. And this very simply just increases their damage for one strain. Later ones will add additional enhancements that become available, such as affecting mystic armor in addition to physical armor, and changing some of the assumptions of how the spell works. Here's a spell knack for Fun with Doors. Because we're terrible people, everything has to be a pun of some kind, so this is Fun with Floors, and it allows you to apply Fun with Doors to different surfaces, not just doors, thus meaning that you're going to get more mileage out of exactly how your Fun with Doors spells works. The strain cost for this hasn't really been settled on yet. We're testing it out to see what's the best number to fit there, so I didn't feel like just putting something in that I knew was going to change. Binding Secrets, I actually haven't seen a lot of talk about Binding Secrets, no matter how much I like them. They too were first introduced in Mystic Paths. They function and have the same role as improved spell knacks in most ways. There's just more roleplay associated with getting them, but you can also have effectively unlimited of them once you've purchased the knack to learn them in the first place. You just have to do something to earn the favor and forge a pact with the named spirit, including learning about the spirit and their name in the first place. The goal is to have nearly all binding spells to get 3 named spirits with binding secrets associated with them. Some of the binding spells already got those 3 or more named spirits in Mystic Paths. The odds are we won't be expanding those anymore, but here's a preview of a couple of those binding secrets. This one is for Mantle the Lightning Vanguard, and it's Kefa the Relentless Storm. And so all of these have a description of what the spirit's like, what they look like, what it's like to deal with them, and then how this changes the assumptions of the binding spell, whether it improves it, alters the function of it in some way, changes the restrictions associated with it. Kefa the Relentless Storm essentially allows you to move at the speed of an airship for a day. It's exhausting and it's expensive. It's a pretty high circle to get access to it, but it allows a small group of people to travel an incredible distance very quickly. As you can also see, it changes how all the successes and extra threads work for the spell. And then we have an aspect of the casual murderer, binding secret, and butcher with a smile. She changes the restrictions on how aspect of the casual murderer works. So you're no longer required to attack allies, only your enemies. Isn't she so nice? The new enchanting we'll be introducing is fetishes, named spells, and wards. Technically, named spells are from previous editions, so that's just reworking them. Fetishes, they were first introduced as the shaman equivalent of a spell matrix, but to be perfectly frank, that was one of the many very problematic things of shamans and why it got removed entirely from them. They have spell matrices just like everyone else now. Fetishes still exist within the setting, and they were part of the early experiments in the creation of spell matrices, kind of parallel to spell matrix objects, which all eventually ended up as the spell matrix talents that we are used today. In application, these are single-use spell matrices tuned to one magician. So you make it for yourself, and no one else can use it. No picking up the fetishes from dead enemies, finding them littered around like scrolls in D&D, even though they have a similar function. You have to make them and use them. They are expensive to make comparatively, however, they still have value to adventuring adepts specifically, because this gives you access to a spell you might not need very often, but when you do, you absolutely have to have it and can't necessarily reattune on the fly. If you take this enchanting knack and invest the time and money, this will open up some more options to you on how to use some of those in a pinch versatility spells you may need. Last chance is a good example, and it's cheaper than a last chance salve. And then we have enchanting named spells. Named spells were a huge problem, as many people may know, in previous editions of Earthdawn. Their implementation was very cool. The idea was cool. Their implementation was not so great. There was some assumptions on how they would function, which also weren't good. It was essentially kind of a nightmare to introduce them. So they've been taken down to the basic idea and rebuilt from there. With the new enchanting system, they're now part of that. In essence, that made redeveloping pretty straightforward, given they're essentially a thread item in many ways. It's like a glyph that's been given a true pattern and life of its own. The biggest problem with them in previous editions was tying a named spell to a person. And that's not possible in 4th edition. Instead, they have to be tied to a location. This removes a lot of the issues while still giving them value, still maintaining pretty much all their story aspects they've come to represent, such as hiding par length in a pocket dimension. All of these things still work, so there's no really retconning in the way the setting is portrayed, just in how named spells are most frequently used. There's some examples, such as Alakia's spells that she seems to have on herself permanently, but there's hacks to that she's figured out. Most notably, if you have access to a pattern item, you can still tie a spell to a location and give your spells exclusive access to it through the pattern item. Gives more reason for Alakia to spend all that time in Bloodwood and really be uninterested in ever leaving or changing the pattern, lest it alter all the threads and enchantments she's put on the location. If you do cast a named spell on a person, essentially the named spell is going to be feeding off of their pattern to power itself, and that really isn't going to go well for them. And there's also much cheaper, less time-intensive ways to kill somebody if that's your ultimate goal, but bond villains are going to bond villain. Wards are the third type of enchanting. This isn't necessarily something players are likely to get up to and is kind of a way to fill a void in the setting that's existed for a long time, because wards have always been there. Magical traps have always been there. There's been discussion about them, but they've never been fleshed out or put into a usable form. If players want to engage with that system, if they want to start building their arcane sanctum, this is filling that gap and giving some guidelines, much like the thread item creation system, on how to do that. As noted, not all spells can become wards. You have to have an extended duration to begin with. A spell with a duration of rounds just isn't going to cut it. The greater the spell's duration to begin with means the less expensive it is and less difficult it is to turn that into a ward and further extend that duration. there's essentially two kinds of wards. There's wards that have a continual function, as in they're always on, and those are the wards you'd experience see on the walls of Care or Citadel, keeping things at bay. And those need continual maintenance and renewal. In the fiction, they talk about young magicians going around and renewing the wards as part of their training, and a regular activity that has to be done constantly through the Care, kind of like bridge inspection on Lake Pontchartrain. Once you finish, you get to start over and do it all again. And the other option is a mana battery, and these wards are most typically in the form of a trap, where it doesn't need constant maintenance. It has a battery that it runs off of, but it only has a limited number of activations before the battery either has to be refilled or the trap dies. So these are the kind of traps you'd see on the outside of a Care, and they can reset themselves, and they'll operate as long as they have mana in the battery. Because going out to recharge them is a pretty terrible idea. No one ever wants that job. But wards, as a whole, always have to be tied to a location, much like a named spell. The biggest stretch goal I have for myself on this topic is familiars. It's a pretty big endeavor, and they haven't been part of 4th edition yet. One of the biggest changes to them is that familiars in 4th edition will be exclusively spirits. They will not be animals. Animals are handled under animal companions. And instead of trying to fit that square peg in a round hole and make everything work, this was a more natural solution, and it set familiars aside as simply being different, which worked well. The premise behind them is you summon a familiar and enter into a pact with them willingly. They can't be coerced. That spirit is reduced down to their bare spirit stuff. What they get out of it is power and name, as you will be investing in them over the course of your life. And once you're dead, they are free to go on their way with a name and additional power. So you could extrapolate from there that a not inconsiderate number of named spirits out there may once have been familiars, and that's why they're a little weird. An important thing for this option is it's useful and available to everyone, not just spellcasters. This should be something that everyone can get, and if it can't get to there in the design, then it's not going to come out, because I want this to be for everyone. That's pretty important. There may be some things more applicable to spellcasters than other characters and vice versa, and that's perfectly fine, but it has to be something that everyone may have a reason for taking. Whereas previously, the only people who were really interested in familiars were spellcasters for that extra matrix, and typically beastmasters because they got a few extra toys for their animal companions. The structure on a whole is similar to a path where you have one talent as kind of the access point that you raise, and then other things you hang off of it to get benefits. And so that's going to be similar. There's going to be those kind of talents that you get access to as you improve the core talent, and those alter and improve your familiar so you can customize it. So that's very important, is that you invest in the growth of your familiar and build how you want them to be. A big downside to the familiar is you can't ever get a second one, particularly if your first one dies. That's it. The spirit community as a whole isn't really going to trust you after that. And what other things might we discuss in Deeper Secrets? Well, I'd like to have some kind of discussion on astral space and sight in there, an in-setting discussion that shows how people perceive it in setting, how it's kind of a personal thing to a certain extent. It isn't necessarily universally perceived the same, since it's going through your talents, and your talents are a manifestation of your perspective through your discipline. There's a lot going into that that isn't shared by everyone in the same way. I'd also like to revisit some things of blood magic that were moved and some new options we've kind of talked about. That really is very brief overview of what's in Magic Deeper Secrets, so we can open this up to some questions. Now, as a disclaimer, and this is really important to me, everything I've talked about here can change because this is still in design and development. We have to test things, get some consensus on what is right, go through the templates and our formulas to figure out if things are working, if they're not. So everything here, there's no promises in here necessarily about what's going to be in there. I just wanted to give people attending an extensive peek on what's going on. Talking about this is perfectly fine, share the video, but if you do talk about it, it's important to me the caveats on this isn't a bunch of promises like these are exactly what's going to be in here, is with that, because those can be shared and they can become promises, and that's pretty discouraging once people build up expectations to have these kind of open discussions and showing what's going on behind the screen before it's ready in the future. So please keep that in mind. And with that, I will happily open this up to discussion. So the question is, I don't see any binding finding secrets and mystic paths. Am I missing something really obvious? You are missing something really obvious. They are absolutely in mystic paths. Page 354 in mystic paths is you'll find spirits binding secrets. Josh conveniently asked if the shaman spell is going to see the same kind of expansion. It will absolutely see that kind of expansion. As I said, everyone is going to get at least 5 spells per circle from 1 through 8. Since shaman is effectively a new discipline, they're seeing a lot more new high circle spells and new low circle spells compared to everyone else. So their list has a lot more new stuff in it, as was true for their current list, but they are going to have roughly the same number of spells as everyone else. New in this context for shaman mean all new spells. Every discipline has all new spells on their lists, period. The other disciplines, the vast majority of their spells are updated from previous editions, though some of the changes are so significant they may as well be new spells. An example of that not shown in here is boil water, which also boil rear water, but its primary function now is kind of a supplemental healing spell to go along with heat food, and that it reduces the time between recovery tests and works well with heat food, boosting that time to cut down your downtime between recovery tests. The number of pages, it's probably going to be mystic path size or greater. So I would guess 400 plus pages. It clearly cannot be larger than the player's guide because that is the physical limitations of the binding. So it's going to be a big kid. The question for that was, what's the number of pages targeted? Shark Force wants to know if there'll be more spells for Nethermasters that play nice with their ability to increase penalties. Yes, there are more spells like that. There was Nether Wave, which I shared. There's also a spell, Pattern Spike, that gives a penalty to a future test the opponent's making. So you kind of have this floating penalty over that target's head. You can then improve with Karma. Ethereal wants to know, between Naxx, more improved spell Naxx enchanting, and more mystic paths, I think. Will this book have multiple dependencies on existing books? Will this and future products explicitly call out somewhere in their front matter which books they are dependent on? The Naxx from Mystic Paths this relies on, which would specifically be the Improved Spell Naxx and Binding Secrets Naxx, those will be reprinted in this book, so it will not rely on Mystic Paths. While it will be useful, it is not required to use this book. This book is going to be part of the core series of books, along with the Player's Guide, Game Master's Guide, and Companion. So the assumption is this book will be one of the ones you need for future books. However, including that kind of disclaimer is not a bad idea, though it is not required specifically for this title. Will this contain any information about Netherworlds? No. This will not delve into the astral space in that way. That is a book Josh and I talked about many, many moons ago during our original development run on the first 3 core books as something that we wanted to visit was the spirit worlds as a whole. Build on spirits a lot, develop out Invey more, a lot of those topics. And it is something I would like to visit in the future, but this is not the text for it, and there wouldn't be the space to do that subject the justice it deserves with the depth we'd like to see for it. Will there be new common magic items, blood charms, and other non-thread magic options? No. This is pretty much limited to player options and those kind of mechanics. Does the spell hold pattern return? Hold pattern freezes an entire spell in time, essentially hanging it ready to be cast. No, that spell is not currently slated to come back in exactly that form. That kind of ability is more appropriate for the hold thread talent, which is handling all of those types of effects. And hold thread does get a lot of Naxx associated with it. That exact effect, I cannot confirm it will be in there, but it will not be as a spell if it does show back up. To go briefly into why this is the case, spells with lots of thread counts, essentially required threads, are very, very powerful, and giving access to them at the first stage of fight, even with exceptional cost associated with it, frequently can end an encounter before it begins. It doesn't even have to be damaging spells. They're typically actually the least obnoxious in that effect. It's the lockdown effects that reduce your opponents to not taking actions as all they're doing is resisting the effects and trying to regain the ability to take actions. And that's not challenging, it's not fun. And so when developing 4th edition, David and I took special care to make sure spells with lockdown effects were more carefully handled and access to them was more difficult, particularly at lower circles through Journeyman, which is why you see them all with required threads, at least 2. 2, and this puts them out of range of a first turn cast for the most part, and why Spliced Weave, the ability to weave threads and cast a spell in one round, is such a high circle ability compared to Concise Casting, which lets you cast 2 spells in one round. Well, you're only going to be casting typically 2 damaging spells or 2 spells with relatively light comparatively lockdown effects, opposed to, you know, Crushing Fist of Earth or Compression Bubble, which are very serious lockdown effects. Being able to then tie extra threads to that, in addition to being able to get the spell off all at once, makes that kind of effect almost a trivial encounter at that point, as everything can be resolved simply by deploying your one uber powerful spell that locks everyone down, and then your friends just have cleanup, which isn't fun for anyone, and I don't think it's going to be particularly fun for the magician in the long run, even though they have to continue doing it because it's the most effective tactic, and why wouldn't they? The Shark Force asked if I could persuade to add a knack to let you use spellcasting knacks as a simple action while retuning on the fly. I mean, you could persuade me to try and do something that I've already done. That was already written a year ago. There's one for each discipline. Requires you to be retuning a spell for that discipline and to use a spellcasting knack associated with that discipline. There may be future more powerful knacks I can either confirm or deny that let you play with those restrictions a little bit, but part of the decision is that appropriate? It favors multi-discipline spellcasters, and that isn't really something we wanted to do as much. We wanted to make sure that while multi-discipline is viable, that a single discipline character is also just as viable. So you don't necessarily encourage or force anyone to go down the multi-discipline road, which is kind of where that starts to go, if that makes sense. Can familiars be used as a battery? Andy asked. I don't know what kind of battery you want to use them as, so maybe you shouldn't get a familiar, because you're going to be a bad familiar, Mommy Andy. And with that, I'm going to bring this to an end. Thank you everyone for being here. I hope the Freedonia Con goes great for everyone. And this is going to be a fun weekend. So thank you again and take care everyone. Have a good night.